There are loads of heroes in Middle-earth. Loads of individuals who stood against the darkness and helped to bring an end to the reign of Sauron. But there is one who stands above all others. Ala Tulia Meldonia Ahara Mariese, my name is Rainbow Dave and welcome to another Tolkien Fun Fact video. So, when Gandalf the White came to the Grey Havens, the Third Age came to an end. When he set sail with the rest of the Ringbearers, a new age of peace and prosperity began. And when he revealed the Ring of Fire upon his finger, the epic conflict that began with Sauron and Celebrimbor 4,963 years earlier finally finished. For over 2,000 years, Gandalf had wandered the wilds and counseled the wise. Over 17 years, he had discovered the truth of the One Ring and identified it in Hobbiton, of all places. And over the span of just 2 months, he had died, come back from the dead, and then orchestrated the greatest and most permanent victory that Arda had ever seen. The downfall of Sauron and the return of the king was the ultimate win for the free peoples of Middle-earth, not to mention the Ainur who adhered to Eru Ilúvatar's vision. And Gandalf? He was the architect of the whole thing. So to fully comprehend the magnitude of Gandalf's contribution, let's go back to the very beginning of his time in Middle-earth. In fact, we'll go back even further, because the entire reason that Gandalf and the other four Istari were sent to Middle-earth in the first place is because of how bleak things were looking at the end of the first millennium of the Third Age. So, pretty much every single bad thing that happened in the First Age happened because an Ainu went rogue and tried to dominate the entire world. Now, by the Second Age, that was pretty much done with, but another Ainu, Sauron this time, also went rogue, and he also tried to dominate the entire world. So, when he was defeated and the Third Age began, the last thing that anyone needed was any more interference from the Ainur. For a brief moment there, it looked like things might just work themselves out on their own. But that did not happen. Within just 2 years of Sauron's defeat, Isildur was dead, and the One Ring was lost in the Anduin. Less than a millennia after that, Isildur's kingdom of Arnor had fallen due to infighting, and it was now divided into 3 rival nations. Things did not look good. So, the Valar of the West decided that they'd help out Middle-earth one final time. But, luckily, they'd kind of learnt from their mistakes. You see, when they helped out against the first rogue Ainu, they flooded an entire continent. When they refrained from helping out against the second rogue Ainu, Eru Ilúvatar broke the world and changed it to a round planet. And again, this flooded an entire nation. So, this time, the powers of the West were ideally hoping to avoid an apocalyptic flood entirely. And that is why the Istari were not sent as warriors to lead armies, but simply as mentors and counselors. They had just one job: to guide the free peoples in their battle against Sauron. Now, this may not sound too challenging, but apparently it was. You see, the two blue wizards, they disappeared into the east, and to be fair, we just don't know enough about their actions to condemn them for anything. But Tolkien does tell us that they did, most likely, fail. Saruman, on the other hand, we can most certainly condemn. He turned into another rogue Ainu, and shock, he also tried to dominate all of Middle-earth. So Saruman failed pretty spectacularly. And Radagast, bless him, he just seemed to lose interest in his task. He never fell into darkness, but it turns out that befriending birds and beasts isn't quite enough of a contribution to be considered a success. Tolkien tells us that he turned aside from his appointed mission, and he goes on to tell us that Radagast was not proud and domineering, but neglectful and easygoing. And thus, he too failed. So, with a failure rate that's now reached 4 out of 5, there's an awful lot of pressure on Gandalf to pull victory out of the bag. And as it goes, he did just that. But he didn't do it with power or with pride. Gandalf's secret weapon throughout his 2,000 years in Middle-earth was wisdom and a profound appreciation for humility. And we'll see this humility a few more times before the end. So, after meeting Glorfindel and Círdan the Shipwright at the Grey Havens, and after being given Narya, the Ring of Fire, Gandalf travelled throughout the West, refusing to settle down, unlike both Radagast and Saruman. And in this time, Gandalf acquainted himself with all the Free Peoples. And we know this by the many names that he soon came to wear. When he went to the Elves, Gandalf became Mithrandir. When he went to the Dwarves, he became Tharkun. And when he went to the Men of the South, he became Incarnus. And so, for many, many years, Gandalf travelled the wilds, watching and waiting. But while Gandalf waited, Middle-earth only seemed to get worse. Over the years, the Nazgûl returned to torment the world. A new shadow lengthened in Dol Guldur, plagues and dragons ravaged the Free Peoples, and beneath the Misty Mountains, a Balrog awoke. Now, Gandalf did take an active role in slowing the spread of this shadow, and the White Council was formed to uncover the secrets of the Necromancer. But this is where we see Gandalf's humility come to the very forefront of his character. You see, Galadriel, she suggested to the White Council that Gandalf should be their leader, but he refused. And this echoes a similar moment thousands of years before, when Manwë, that's the King of Arda, the King of the Valar, also appointed Gandalf, who was known back then as Olorin, to be one of the Istar. And again, Olorin initially refused. In fact, it was this very humility that convinced Manwë that Olorin was indeed the perfect choice to join the Istari. And Gandalf's humility, along with his appreciation for those who live humble lives, may explain the origin of his portentous friendship with the secretive race of hobbits. It seems that Gandalf knew, either consciously or otherwise, that this modest race of halflings would one day move the wheels of the world. And while the eyes of the great were elsewhere, Gandalf spent a great deal of time watching over the Shire. Which brings us to Gandalf's nature as a guide as opposed to a leader. Now, it's a subtle distinction, but throughout all of the quests that Gandalf takes part in, he seems to have a pretty innate knowledge of when he ought to guide and when he ought to bow out and let others lead the quest onwards. After all, it isn't Gandalf who slays Smaug. It isn't Gandalf who reclaims Erebor. And it isn't Gandalf who rebuilds Dale. And yet, if it weren't for his chance meeting with Thorin, none of these things would have happened. Which would mean that during the northern sphere of the War of the Ring, Dale and Erebor would not have been there to repel the armies of Sauron. But they were, thanks to Gandalf, even though he was busy in the south at the time. And of course, none of these things are anywhere near the most significant outcome of Gandalf's involvement in the quest of Erebor. If not for his foresight in regards to Bilbo Baggins, the One Ring would not have been found beneath the Misty Mountains, and it would not have made its way into the hands of the Free Peoples. So, for the first 2,017 years of his time in Middle-earth, Gandalf was the man behind the curtain. He was the wise watcher and the one who put plans into motion, which moved the gears of resistance. For many years, he'd fostered a friendship with Aragorn, and he quietly worked towards restoring him to the throne of the Dúnedain. And a few years later, he'd taken Faramir, son of Denethor, as his pupil, and instructed him in the ways of wisdom. Now, in the coming years, both of these friendships would end up literally saving the world. But in his 2,018th year, Gandalf was suddenly thrust into the spotlight. Because in the year 3,018 of the Third Age, the time of watching and waiting had officially come to an end. Now, we all know about Gandalf's contributions throughout The Lord of the Rings, and I'm not going to tell that story here. But on the 25th of January in the year 3019, everything came crashing down. Gandalf died. Now, he didn't fail in his task, but his body did fail against the Balrog. And Gandalf passed away. Well, at least for 20 days he did. Because, of course, Eru Ilúvatar himself would not allow Gandalf to leave Middle-earth just yet. Now, after being reborn, Gandalf faced an epic race to the finish line. You see, there were only 25 days between being reunited with the three hunters and the final destruction of Sauron. But in those 25 days, Gandalf turned the tide of war from disaster to absolute victory. The very next day after meeting Aragorn and Legolas and Gimli in Fangorn Forest, Gandalf arrived in Edoras, where he roused King Theoden from his hopelessness. And the day after that was the Battle of the Hornburg, and the following morning, Gandalf arrived with Erkenbrand and 1,000 Rohirric reinforcements. And the next day would see Gandalf riding with Pippin to Minas Tirith, where he would oversee the defense of the last bastion of resistance against Sauron. So, on the 15th of March, everything came to a head. On the fields of Pelennor, the forces of Mordor were driven back. But far to the east, in both Mirkwood and Lothlorien, the elves came under an attack of their own. And up in the far north, the kingdoms of Erebor and Dale were besieged. There were now only 10 days left on the War of the Ring. So this was the reality that Gandalf and the other Free Peoples faced on the day of the last debate. And during this debate, Gandalf was unanimously chosen by the three Lords of the West, that's Aragorn, Éomer, and Prince Imrahil, to be their leader in the final battle. Now, this is possibly the first time in his entire existence that Gandalf graduated from being a guide to being a genuine leader. And in the last week of the War of the Ring, everything Gandalf had ever done would culminate in one final battle. Now, I don't want to imply that Gandalf alone saved Middle-earth. We know that there were a huge number of other heroes who took the reins. But all of them have Gandalf somewhere in their genesis, guiding them towards their fated end. After all, it was Gandalf's idea to march on the Black Gate and to draw Sauron's armies away from Frodo. It was Gandalf who set Frodo off on his quest in the first place, It was Gandalf who insisted that Sam go with him. It was Gandalf who persuaded Bilbo to go on the adventure in which the ring was found in the first place. And it was Gandalf who taught Frodo to treat Gollum with pity. All of these events had to play out in exactly the way that they did for the ring to be destroyed. And yet, they're all kind of like ripples in time that were set in motion by Gandalf. Even Aragorn, the titular king who so famously returned, owes much of his fate to Gandalf. And he may not even know the full extent of it. You see, the reason that Aragorn takes the title King Elessar is because the Elessar was an elfstone that was given to him by Arwen's grandmother Galadriel as a wedding gift from the bride's family to the groom. But who gave Galadriel this stone in the first place? Who else but Gandalf? 2,000 years before Aragorn was even born, Gandalf prophesied to Galadriel that she would one day pass this stone to a man, and because of it, he would take up the name Elessar. So, let's now skip forward again to the Grey Havens, and to Gandalf's departure from Middle-earth. Alongside the rest of the Ringbearers and Shadowfax, Gandalf passed into the west, leaving Middle-earth in its most peaceful and prosperous state ever. Now, this is where the story ends, and so Gandalf's fate beyond this moment is a mystery. Yet I find it truly heartwarming to imagine Gandalf's reception when he arrived back in the west. 2,022 years ago, he'd been sent across the sea to dwell in a land of war and darkness. All four of his fellow Istari failed. Over the centuries, the power of Mordor only grew. The kingdoms of men were gripped by despair. But Gandalf succeeded in his mission. He did what he was sent to do. And 2,022 years later, the darkness was vanquished, and a new king had returned. I feel like the victory of the Free Peoples over Sauron was a bit like a complex machine. There were thousands of cogs and wheels that all had to turn at the exact right time and in the exact right way for victory to be achieved. And yet the spark, the jolt of electricity that set the machine in motion, was Gandalf. Just imagine how great he must have felt to return to Valinor, to throw off the raiment of Gandalf, and to return to his angelic form as Olorin. There is perhaps no one in the entire history of Arda who did a better job than him. The victory of the West was his victory. Gandalf pulled off the ultimate win. So, I hope you enjoyed this video. Hit like and subscribe if you did, and let me know your thoughts on Gandalf in the comments. But, as always, until next time, my dear friends, much love. Stay groovy, and Nevaeh Melanine.